Without any further delay, coming to tonight's session on how to prioritize and test the most critical assumptions about your idea. Let me give an introduction to our very distinguished and eminent speaker of tonight, Gaurav Soni. Gaurav is the founder and owner of Lean Apps. He's passionate about digital healthcare problems and ideas which are directly linked to people's lives. He has extensive experience in validating, building, and launching multiple digital products for retail, music, healthcare, and telecom using lean experiments, design sprint, and agile framework. Gaurav loves solving problems for his customers, teams, colleagues, and vendors. He always had a passion from the start of his career to be an entrepreneur and is happy to be on the right path. He also loves mentoring and coaching people in product management, product leadership, and all the aspects of building a scalable and profitable product. A very warm welcome to you, Gaurav. We are absolutely thrilled to have you here with us tonight. Hand the session over to you.
I really appreciate that. Let me, thanks for introducing me. And yeah, so that's great. And welcome all on this event. So without spending a lot of time talking about myself, let's jump into what we have today to discuss on the product management. Let me share my screen. Give me a second. Cool. So let's start. Thanks, Shama, for bringing this opportunity for us to talk on this topic, which is very close to my heart. And thanks, everyone, for joining. So I'll not repeat my introduction. That's already been done. I'm sure there are a lot of people today who have joined the session who are pursuing product management as a career, and or some of you would be looking to shift to the product management as your next career move. So I got the product management bug three years back, though the whole journey of Lean Apps has been 5-6 years. But I think that's where I got and fell in love with product management. And yeah, that's how I've built my skills, learned about it, had a couple of failures, and that has been a wonderful journey. So about Lean Apps quickly, we have been working with a lot of innovation and product management teams at Bayer, BMW, Zayas, BMG, a couple of more customers. I'll briefly touch base today on the role of a product management from the ideation, validation, product design, and development to scale up. However, today we'll focus mostly on one of the topics which is very highly missed in the product management journey, which is how you can validate your ideas without building a product. And I love to love if somebody would challenge me and ask questions where they don't believe in this. Great. So what's the agenda for today? We'll talk about how we can structure and come out with the most critical assumptions about the idea through the assumption sprint framework. We'll learn how to convert these assumptions into a testable hypothesis. Assumption and hypothesis are a lot of times confused within their terminology. Some people say they are same. So I'll differentiate between both of them today to bring clarity to all the product leaders and product managers and prospecting product managers, how you define assumptions, how you turn them into hypotheses. We'll go through some marketing hacks. Nothing like a rocket science. Everything is available today. So we have created some hacks to generate evidence around all our assumption and hypothesis. And we'll give free access to all the frameworks and canvases our team has built in last 2 years to scale up your product journey. It's cool, let's start. I think this slide, I'm sure everybody would have seen in some or the other book or a blog or, while reading stuff. So for any idea to succeed, multiple assumptions need to be validated. So we speak to like 8 to 10 product teams in a week across different business verticals, different industries. And every team believes that their idea is amazing and it has to succeed. Everyone talks about solution, implementation, technology, launching the product. However, in any of the discussion I hear very less people talking about, oh, this is my customer segment, or this is the problem that I'm trying to solve for them. Sad part is no one wants to go the easy way to validate it before building it. We love doing the hard work. We love building things. Everyone is great at execution. And this is where most of the product leaders that I've been talking to struggle a lot. Why? I believe because they are very busy in their day-to-day life executing the product roadmap rather than focusing on what problems they are solving and validating them. So what's the common pattern in 9 of the 10 ideas that fail? Now, if you see, the journey of a product starts with a killer idea in mind. Idea starts with the solution with a vague definition of the customer segment and the problems. Everyone does market research, go through analyst reports from Gartner, McKinsey. So a lot of data is available on the internet. Look for similar products in the market. Based on the market research, build a fancy business plan. Maybe talk to some of the customers or prospects who you already know. And usually they never say no to you. And either they say yes to you. So secure funding, assemble the team, and start execution. And this keeps the team busy for 5 to 6 months, building their MVPs, launching it. Then marketing team comes in, pump money to acquire customers. By the time when you're so much deep into development of the product, everybody starts loving it, gets emotionally attached. And in a few months later, after launching the product, they get to know that nobody's really interested in the idea. Why does it happen? Like, why is it a pattern? In fact, we also went through the same journey. So I want to share a story about one of the products we launched 3 years back in our dream world, which eventually failed. So dreams sometimes are very costly. We invested around 100,000 euros building a product for retail and F&B market. We got so emotionally attached to the product that it was very difficult to get out of that idea. And where we were getting signals that this is not working anywhere. We launched it in UAE. We tried in Europe. We tried in India. The good part was problem existed in the market, but once we launched the product, just by learning, okay, there is a problem in the market, let's go and solve it. Nobody was willing to pay for that. The customer segment for us was too vague. One of our partners is still in his dream world and he decided to go solo. So this is the innovation funnel, which we follow with the different product and innovation teams that we work with. So if you see the first part here is the ideation part. So this is where you start collecting the problems and filter the ideas based on your strategic fit. So there might be like you're working on multiple ideas, a company like Microsoft or Amazon, they have different products. Maybe if you're working on a product, there might be ideas that or the problems that you might be solving for different customers. So you try to fit your problems linked to a strategic fit. You validate all your assumptions and hypotheses through experiments. Then you prototype your validated ideas using design sprint or design thinking. Build your first version of the product. Some companies smaller in size have product leaders or managers doing everything from ideation to validation, execution, and growth of the product. However, as the company grow big, the product management role becomes very focused. This is where you can see where you want to be in your career when it comes to starting your product management role or product managers trying, you know, planning to move to different roles. So most of the product managers, what I see are doing a product owner role, busy executing and developing features without validating it. I'll not get into the details, but this could be, we can do another session later that how you can progress your career and see which one suits you, which one you love doing it. Our focus for today will be step two. How can you validate and experiment really fast to test all your assumptions? So it doesn't really matter if you have an existing product or a new product. Experiment-driven approach, I believe, is more like a mindset. It's very important for the organizations to adapt to this culture in coming time. So let's start with the first agenda for today. For today.
Hey, Gaurav, just a quick reminder on the polls. Let me know when you want to take the poll.
Definitely.
Sure.
So how to structure the most critical assumptions? So what is assumption sprint? So I told you in my last one of my slides that will differentiate between the assumption and hypothesis. So this framework will help you define and filter your most critical assumptions that can make and break your idea. So what's an assumption? An assumption is a general feeling. I'm very categorically saying feeling about a business problem or the customer segment or a solution. So it's your belief how the target market or a customer segment will engage with your product. Now, there could be multiple scenarios. Does your customer really care about the problem you're solving? Or does it really care about your product that you're building? Do they have alternatives to solve the problem if their product doesn't exist? Are they willing to spend money if the problem is solved? How much are they willing to pay? Are they willing to use again and again, engage with the product, adapt it, and or recommend it to the friends? This is a step-by-step process to run the innovation sprint. So what you do is you start with the constraints. We'll discuss the constraints in the next detailed stuff. Collect the problems and the customer segment you want to target. Vote for the problems of the customer segment you want to validate. Convert that into we believe statements. Filter the ones that are most critical for your idea. At the end of the assumption sprint, this is a 90-minute exercise. It's not that you're brainstorming and doing these sessions for days and days. So at the end, what you get is a lot of we believe that statements for which you have no evidence. And this is all based on your belief or your assumptions. So the goal is to take these assumptions and test it before you build it. So I was talking about the constraints. So we start with defining constraints. So why constraints are important? When there are no constraints during the idea generation process, people usually go into their intuitive dream world based on their gut feel that comes in the mind. The ideas become very unfocused with no strategic fit, not aligned to the company vision, or have no clear outcomes. It becomes really challenging for teams to decide what idea or the problem to solve. And they end up generating a lot of ideas, but they're random and unfocused. In fact, management push a lot of ideas. This is a complaint I think every product leader says. My management is pushing their ideas and it demotivates me, demotivates my team. So this whole structure, if you see, brings a lot of alignment in the team and management buy-in. So here are some of the examples which can give the reference, which can be used as references to set up constraints so that the teams get a direction while generating ideas around the problems or the customer segment or solutions. I've taken the example of company vision and strategy here. For example, Tesla, if you go to the first one. So the Tesla focus or the vision is around sustainable energy. So whatever problem they're solving, it's around this vision. And whenever teams are ideating or creating new ideas, so they will keep this in mind and then, you know, come out with solutions of the problems they want to solve. However, the latest Bitcoin investment by Elon Musk, which has increased the Bitcoin price, I think this should be touching 50 very soon, 50,000, is not linked to this vision anyhow. Might be he wants to move away from the paper currency, digital currency, and trying to go towards saving trees. So there are some more examples here, which is now for more on the customer segment, which you can use as a constraint. I wrote a detailed post on LinkedIn on the constraints. You can read through and learn more about it. So step two, this is a very important step where a lot of product teams fumble, which I've been mentioning in all my slides. So customer segments are generally very vague, which I've seen. Problem statements are more like solutions. So when you start defining it, you actually start defining a solution rather than saying, oh, there's a problem that exists. This is one of my favorite slides. So we call this growth box. So before you deep dive into defining the customer segment or the problems, decide on what you want to focus on. This brings a common focus in the team so that the ideas generated will be very focused on a specific quadrant rather than random ideas. It's a combination of the customer segment and the problems. So define your customer segment first. That's where you go along, okay, which customer segment I want to target. Are you targeting a new customer segment or existing customer segment if you have an existing product? Then you decide if you want to focus on existing problems or want to go with new problems for the customer segment. And that's how you build a matrix and see whether you want to focus on 1, 2, 3, or 4. So you can look at it later in details. We have created this customer and segment, customer and problems, problem and customer segment canvas. So you can download this. We'll share the presentation and you can deep dive into the specific questions that you should answer. Some of the examples which we are focusing are like, what is the problem? What is the root cause of the problem? What is the impact if the problem is not solved? What will be the aha moment of the customer if the problem is solved? So we try to answer all that based on whatever you have learned, what your belief is. And from this, what you eventually do is get them converted to we believe statements that we were discussing in the previous slides. So these are some of the examples on how to define a problem in the customer segment. I know some people would feel that this is so stupid, but this is where a lot of teams struggle. And I was mentoring a team 2-3 days back. So they are working on an idea to help farmers use the pesticides in the field effectively to increase the soil productivity. The first question, my favorite, was, okay, what's the customer segment? So the answer was, we are targeting farmers from Europe and Asia Pacific. So if you see, Asia Pacific and Europe are two continents. Now, you can't reach out to your customer segments in weeks, because when you're doing your validation, you're not doing for months. You're going to generate data and evidence in weeks or maybe days. This is, if you see this example, the customer segment is very vague. It's very broad. Finally, after a lot of argument, they decided, okay, we'll nail down to cities. They were not happy. But this was also, I told them, this is really big. You have to really go down, make it very small, and take it to a level where it's very easy for you to reach with your minimal testable market. So we'll learn today how to narrow down the customer segment in the upcoming slides. So once you have your problems, your customer segments, your constraints, this is where you start voting for the problem in the customer segment. Now, that's this is where people are not fighting with each other. You just go put a sticky note to what you think you should focus on. And if the one thing what we should, you should always ensure is that if there are too many customer segments, try to nail it down to one. I always love one, but maximum you should go is with two to very early on to avoid any confusions later. Filter the top voted problems and prioritize them based on the votes. So you start with the one that gets the maximum vote. There is still a lot of things there where management will come and jump, oh no, let's not do this, let's try something else. But if this process goes inside the organization, I think over a period of time, people or the management starts getting aligned to this. So once you have everything together, then you convert all your prioritized problems and customer segments to we believe that statements. It's very simple. So here's an example from one of the team I was mentoring a couple of days back. So they're working on a retail product. So you define the problem as we put it in the poster on the green. And you just say, okay, we believe that, and the problem statement. Now, same could go for a customer segment. You say, okay, our X product, which you already have, you want to target to a new customer segment. And you say, okay, we believe that this product can be sold, or we can validate with X customer segment or Y customer segment, and so on. This is the step 6, which is very critical. And this, what you do here is start mapping all your assumptions that you have, or you call it your we believe statements, into this critical, non-critical, unknown, known quadrant. On the y-axis, you define the criticality of the assumption, how important or critical this assumption is for your idea to succeed or fail. On the x-axis, you focus on the evidence. Do you have enough evidence or data, not your belief, that your assumption is whatever assumptions you're putting is right? So the goal is to filter out the most critical and unknown assumptions, which you see on the right top quadrant, for which you have no evidence. Now, critical and unknown assumptions are the ones which you will test first to validate your idea. So once you have the critical assumptions in place, we'll see how you're going to convert them into testable hypothesis. Maybe we can take a break for 2 minutes, Shama, and go through the poll.
Sure, Gaurav. I'll launch it right away. So the first question is up, guys. Please cast your votes so that we know your answers to this. Gaurav, can you see the results?
Yep. So I was not wrong.
Product execution has the highest votes, followed by product validation,
which is great. But I think, yeah, I'll definitely like to have questions around the validation. Maybe if people have a different, I think it's the second question might, yeah, let's see the second question.
Sure.
Answer that.
We'll give them a few more seconds to vote.
Yep.
Right, so we have the results here. Great. Validating and testing new ideas, followed by alignment with the management and the team.
Great, yeah. Good, so I think, yeah, we have something around alignment and management with the team. So we created alignment sprint. maybe we can run another session around that. That's also
definitely
very but I think that's good that I think the biggest challenge has been what I see again. I think the results are good, so it's validating and testing new ideas which we are talking. Great, thanks everyone to participate. I'll quickly try to wrap up this presentation so that we can have a lot of questions around validation and testing, and let's see how it goes. Thanks Amma.
Thank you.
Perfect. So I'll quickly recap what we have done so far. So we decided to first create our assumptions, and from the assumptions, whatever we have collected. So assumptions are, it could be around your features, your roadmap. It could be around your problems or the customer segment. What you're targeting. So and assumptions are nothing but your we believe that statements. Now, if you remember in my previous slide, I said assumptions are vague. It's really difficult to, it's your belief. Now, how do you ensure that whatever you believe is right or wrong? And that's where you start defining now your assumptions and convert them into a testable hypothesis. So this is the next part of it, which we'll learn. So if you see the slide, I've brought an example of one of the ideas I am recently working on. I'll not disclose much on that, but yeah, this is where you convert, I was explaining, as your we believe statements into your assumptions into hypothesis. So what's hypothesis? I'm putting the Wikipedia statement here, not mine. So hypothesis is an educated guess or prediction about a relationship between two variables. I'm sure everyone would have had maths and equations and variables in the school. So it must be a testable statement, something that can support or falsify with the evidence. So let's go through the example here. So I've put both the assumption and the hypothesis so that you can easily correlate how we extract the hypothesis from the assumption. So I'm working on an idea to help smokers in India quit smoking. I'm sure there will be some smokers in the session. So the idea is to build a breathing device for smokers who want to quit smoking, when this could be a good platform for me to quickly test if smokers would really go for this. So when they breathe through the device, it will give an indication. So it will have an indicator on the device, which will tell you the quality of the lungs. So when I say quality of the lungs, the quality of air of the lungs. So red, amber, or green. So it's not that we are saying the device will say, okay, stop smoking. It will give you an indication whether you should go for your next smoke or not. So if you see point number two, the we believe statement. So we believe, as in our team, that chain smokers in India who want to quit smoking would be interested in a reasonably priced device to help them monitor their lungs. So this covers that, okay, they want to quit smoking. That means we are targeting people who are chain smokers, they're addicted, and this is a problem they want to solve for them. But if you read the statement again, it's a vague statement. Can I go and test it? No. So how do I test it? So that's where you bring this hypothesis piece in the picture. And if you read the statement, at least X percent of Y. So what is Y? Y is your target market. Will do Z. What is Z? Z is the action or the behavior. So if you read the statement now, it says, we believe that 30% of the people living in Delhi who smoke more than 10 cigarettes a day will buy a 100 euro device to monitor their lungs and quit smoking. So what has changed in 2 and 3? So from India, so we were talking about now 30% of people living in Delhi. So we have reduced our target market now. So from India, now the focus is Delhi. So if you remember the last example, which I said, we want to target farmers from Asia Pacific and Europe. So, but now as you see, you're narrowing down your market. Second is people. So you're filtering. You're again retargeting your market and saying, rather than focusing everyone, we only want to focus on people who are smoking more than 10 cigarettes in a day. Third, we are putting a price. So we want to check whether people are willing to pay. Initially, it was reasonably priced. Now we are saying, okay, we'll test whether they are willing to pay 100 euros for this device. So the target market, we believed, was still big. Now, if you assume that 5% of the population in Delhi smokes, I'm not talking about people who are smoking the pollution, but who are smoking as in doing active smoking. So we are talking about half a million of people. So this is also huge considering the population of Delhi is 1 million. So remember the example again that I gave you about the continents. So what do you do now here? So we are still that market is really big for us, but we know, okay, we have a price tag to it. We know that we are targeting people who are smoking 10 cigarettes a day, but we'll further hyper zoom and reduce our target market. So if you see now statement number 5 and 6, so do you think that this is testable quickly now? If you read the hypothesis statement, or which is number 6. So let's read that quickly. And so we believe that 30% of people smoking more than 10 cigarettes a day visiting a pulmonologist. So pulmonologist is nothing but a doctor who takes care of lungs at Hospital X in Delhi will buy a 100 euro device to monitor their lungs and quit smoking. So if you see now, this is, we're talking about one hospital, one doctor. If he's doing 20 patients a day, you can just walk in or talk to the doctor and say, hey, I want to do a quick experiment with the doctors, with the patients or with the doctor, and you can quickly validate your idea. If you spend a week with them, so you get your target market at one hospital for in a week, which is around 100, 200, 250 people. So be very aggressive when you're validating your idea, hyper-zooming it. Make sure you're going out of the building. Validation experiment doesn't happen sitting in the office with your market research or your Gartner reports. And that's where I brought this example where we physically went out and tested our idea. However, don't zoom it so much that the target subset becomes very small, like 5 to 10 people, because it whatever they say to you, it may not give you a pattern or a sense. And avoid going to your relatives or friends for this idea, for your idea. Stay away from them, because it's not that they're your enemies. Problem is that they're so close to you that they won't feel you telling the truth, that whether your idea really sucks or is it good to go. 100 to 500 people in your initial target market is a good stats to start with. So now that we have the hypothesis ready, it's ready to experiment. So this is how you design an experiment. Step one, again, I'm reiterating on the most critical assumption that you had. So you decide your experiment now. So you choose one of the experiments you want to test your hypothesis with. For us, what we choose is to run a discovery interview with smokers for a week, and then create a landing page, run ads on the Facebook and Instagram to generate enough evidence if the idea is worth, to test our hypothesis. A simple hypothesis statement that we create. Step three is to define your success criteria. So our success criteria was that if whatever validation we wanted to do, how will it hold successful? If 30 patients out of 100 say that, yes, we want to buy their device, we'll say our hypothesis is correct. So you need to really define what will be your success criteria, success measurement. Step four is skin in the game. Now, not telling you to go and take the skin of your users. It's more about what he gives you as you call it, like a currency or a coin or something which is important for him. So we had their email address and phone numbers, which we took, which were valid, a valid email address, which they regularly check, and their phone number, of course, India, people usually communicate via phone, so that we can let them know once the device is out in the market. What is also important is to time box your experiment. So we time box for a week, and we reached around, 15, around 100 people. And yeah, it gave us a good data to go and do the second experiment, which I was explaining on the landing page and the ads. So here is our experiment menu, which can be used to validate hypothesis for your ideas. So we have a link in the next slide, which detail out the outcomes of every experiment. So you can choose your experiment based on what stage you are at. So I've also attached the link which details all the experiments as I was explaining with clear outcomes. So start very small. If you are not into experiments as such as a company, you'll get a lot of resistance from the teams and the management initially, because we believe that, okay, this is right. How can experiment tell whether we are right or wrong. However, once you start showing results, because I think what's important is that when you start generating evidence, I'm sure they will love it. And it becomes, as I said, it becomes a mindset or a habit in the organization that, yeah, we'll not build anything without generating evidence and validating it. So don't just rely on one experiment. A lot of teams make mistake when they start using experiment as a service. So what happens, you need to run multiple experiments to arrive on the conclusion. So it's arrive on the conclusion that, okay, we have enough evidence now to really go and pursue the idea. We have done overall, I think, five, six experiments so far. We are still doing more. And it is also important that if you're doing experiment in India, for example, or say in Delhi, even if you go from Delhi to say south or to west, people behavior might change. So you really need to see and nail down, how and to which level you want to experiment it. But I think with the experiment approach, what happens is that your decisions now are not biased. They're not management driven. They're not on your gut feel, but it's on gut feel and data, which helps you to take a right decision. This is the infographic we created for experiments, which explains when to use what experiment. So the left part is focused purely on the validation of problem in the customer segment. The second is focused purely on validating your solution. So these are challenges. So you start with the journey on the left side, then you go to the second, then you go to the third one. So that's it for today. I really appreciate you listening to our story. Let's stay in touch via LinkedIn, and thanks for your time. I'm ready for any questions.
Thank you for delivering a brilliant session, Gaurav. Really great insights. And we already have quite a few questions lined up for you. So let's begin with the Q&A session then. Give me a moment to share my screen. Meanwhile, you can have a look at the questions in the Q&A window.
Q&A, yeah. How can
audience, please. I'm sorry. Yeah. Yes, I'm going to read it out, Gaurav. No problem. Sure. So audience, please ask your questions in the Zoom Q&A window or on the LinkedIn thread, and we can direct them to the speaker. There are a few questions by Deepak here, Gaurav. So he has raised his hand as well. Can I call him online? Is that okay with you?
Yeah. Right.
Deepak, please go ahead and ask your question.
Hi, thanks, Nina. Thanks, Gaurav, for the wonderful question. I have a few questions around the experiments itself. I work for a US firm. The IT team, the product.
Deepak, sorry, your voice is breaking. I can't hear you clearly.
Is it okay now?
Yes, much better, Deepak. Go on.
Okay. I work for a US firm. The IT team sits here. I am the product manager for a couple of products, and I directly talk to our business who is in US. Mm-hmm. Now, last year, I did propose an idea by doing competitor analysis and seeing where we lack. But I have a few more ideas. But to experiment that, I have to talk to the end consumers who are in the US and to whom I don't have any direct connect. So what experiments can we do for such geographical where I cannot reach to the consumers directly?
Sure. Yeah. Your product is a B2B product or it's a B2C product?
The one which I want to propose is a B2C product, but it will go through our business. We have a default servicing business wherein we handle foreclosures. So there will be investors who would be waiting for the foreclosure properties. Mm-hmm. And I want to propose some idea to those investors who are our end consumers with whom we don't have any direct connect.
Okay. But they are already your customers. So I'm sure you would have some data, their email addresses, their contacts, so it's not important that for every experiment, you have to really go offline. There are a lot of online experiments as well. So if you go through the experiment, infographic that I shared, of course, it will be shared with you, after the presentation. So you can run any kind of experiment. So it's not important that if people are geographically sitting at a different location, you can't run it from India. So you could run discovery interviews. And now I think with COVID, everyone understands it's very easy to get people on Zoom, get to a discovery call. Depends, okay, you want to focus on the problem or the solution, you can bring it in front of them. So you really need to find where your consumers are sitting and target that platform. Like for me, if I say I do like a 6 to 8 calls and all organic, zero spend on any ads, and 90% of our pipeline of business is generated from LinkedIn. And the way we do is we do outreach campaigns. Our team is focused there. We go on the calls, talk to them, and they just come and give business to us. So what I'm saying is you need to really nail down. You know your customer segment. You already have a product. What you need to do is find out where they sit. If you already have the data, maybe you can run an email campaign, run a survey, try to generate evidence and data before you build a product.
Yeah, suppose if there's no, it's an entirely new idea and we don't have any prior customers for that customer segment,
yeah.
Then which experiments would you suggest?
Again, as I said, the first step that if you remember the presentation, what you see is the first thing you start defining is your customer segment. Who is your prospective customer? How it looks like? So the canvas that I've mentioned in the presentation, so you'll be able to download it. You start filling it, fill your assumptions. And again, it's going and finding your customer segment. So somewhere your customer segment is sitting. Now, if it's a B2C, depending on which market you are in, people are on Instagram, people are on Facebook, they are on B2B is highly recommended. LinkedIn works really well. So you find that customer segment and test your customer segment first. It's not important that you start with X customer segment and then your product gets validated with that customer segment. A lot of times when I test it, you start with X, but you land on a Y or a Z customer segment. It's all about first putting all your assumptions on the table and then trying to find out. Experiment is a third stage. So what you first try to do is, where would your prospective customer segment sit? Go on those platforms. Like even if you have to acquire your initial customers from say LinkedIn ads or from Facebook ads or Instagram ads, it's not that you're spending a lot of money on these ads. You just run these experiments for 4 or 5 days try to see whether this is the right customer segment for your product or not. So actions that you create in your you put the problem in front of them, you put the solution in front of them, and if you see the skin in the game, so that data gives you a real evidence whether this is the right customer segment or are they really aligned to the problems or not. But the best experiment that I always propose people to start when they're starting new is try to discover, do the discovery interviews. That really helps.
Okay. Thank you, Gaurav. I have another question quickly. You mentioned that 30% of smokers in Delhi. So is there any science or way to determine what that number should be? Or it is just by gut feeling that, okay, if I get 30%, that's...
Exactly. It's your gut feel. I also mentioned that. There is no... It's all vague. So when you're putting your hypothesis, and then when you test it, that's where you get evidence. So whatever I'm putting there is just a hypothesis. But what I have to make sure is, the biggest mistake, as I said, people make is when they look at a very huge, a big customer segment. Right, you have to really, really nail down. Like we ran experiment with 2 hospitals, and we were able to make out whether this is the right fit or not.
Mm-hmm. But again, that becomes an assumption, right? If I say 30% met, and when I roll it out in a bigger scale, that 30% might not be good for business sustenance.
You will go, you change your assumption and make it 50%, make it 60%. So it's a number game. So you decide, okay, at what number will my business make a lot of sense. Initially, it's too early to say, okay, I want to go and, as I said, you're not putting a business plan together. Think it like, okay, you're first going and validating it. Do people really want the product or not? Are they really, or what about the product? Are they really understanding the problem or not? And this is not like one, it's not like one and zero. This experiment journey continues in the whole cycle. So this will continue when you build the product. This will continue when you go and find your product market fit. This will still continue when you're doing your design sprint. So experiment is a mindset, as I said. Everything that you want to launch, whether it's an existing product or a new product, you have to do an experiment and run that way. And this is something which is not coming from me. If you see companies like Amazon or Airbnb or you know, all sort of, even a classic example is Tesla. Or Tesla, when they decided to launch the car, they didn't make the car. They went, you go on the website, you say, okay, sign up and pay €1,000, $1,000 deposit, and you can own the car. Now, this is what, an experiment, that how many people are really interested in buying the car before you really go and start putting investment in, you know, putting the manufacturing plant, start putting a huge investment there.
Sure. Thanks a lot, Gaurav.
Thank you, Deepak, for the great question. And this was an amazing discussion, Gaurav.
Sure.
So, but let's move on to the next questions. Let's take a few questions from the Q&A window now.
Sure.
Subhash asks us, how do you nail down your experiment market from the target market you have in mind? Is there any way to find that?
Well, I think from an assumption perspective, target market, as I said, it's a number game. So what you're trying to do is narrow it down. So in the class example, I said that, okay, I am targeting people who smoke. I can also put an age to it. I can put a gender to it. Depending on whether it's a B2B customer segment or a B2C customer segment, you can answer those questions specific to that. And then what you're trying to do is whatever assumptions you're defining for your customer segment, validation is a step where you go and experiment and see whether that was right or that was wrong. So as such, there is no science or a method behind it. It's just that you start defining your assumptions, and then the second step, you say, let me convert into a testable hypothesis, which can be tested very fast. And that's where you narrow down your segment, customer segment. Does it answer your question?
Sure, it definitely should. So we'll take this next question from a LinkedIn viewer, Melby. How would you go about convincing management on the need for experiment when the company has never done so? What key points would you suggest to build the case?
That's a very good question. And we always get this question from the teams who have never done experiments. I think the experiment is, if you see, the cost of running experiments is really, really cheap, I would say. Like, let me put it very clearly, compared to building a feature or building a product. So what you need to really do is, as I said in one of the slides, also I mentioned that, yeah, it will be very difficult for people to really go and convince the management. You have to show them data. So if you can run some experiments where you're not spending maybe on ads, going and just doing discovery interviews, finding customers, where you put some efforts without asking for big budgets, that should be, I think, the right way. So the goal here is, if you try to go and convince people, okay, we have to run experiments, this is what people are doing, they may or may not get convinced. What's important is go with data, go with facts with them. So people love data. People when you take your statements, or when you take your when you go for buy-ins with the management with data, then it's very difficult for them to really say no to it. But start very small. As I said, try to do experiments which are very, very cheap. Budgets are very, very low, where the management just says, okay, yeah, go and run, do a €100 test, which is running a couple of ads on Facebook and Instagram, or go do a simple outreach on LinkedIn and reach customers using a sales navigator or something which is not very costly. So as I said, with experiments, go very lean initially, and then you slowly scale up and generate more experiments and build a team of which can focus very heavily on the experiment piece.
Great. I hope that answers your question, Melvi. And now jumping to the next question. This is again from a LinkedIn viewer called Pranamika. How crucial is success metrics in these experiments? Should we be very rigid with that?
Yes. Well, if I understand, yes, you should be very rigid with that. Why? Because unless a lot of times what happens is, as I was mentioning, that you still, a lot of times people, nine of the 10 ideas, if I mentioned, now why do they fail? Because they're rigid with their assumptions that, no, I am right. What I'm assuming, whatever I'm putting on the table is right. So with experiment, when it becomes very rigid, it becomes a habit. You see the data is either it's in favor of your assumption or they're not in favor of your assumption. And if they're not in your favor of your assumption, and you're still going and making a mistake of building a product, that's your choice. But that rigidity at least gives you a lot of clarity whether I'm going the right direction or I'm going the wrong direction. So don't take experiments. And sometimes it's like It again depends. You know, it's not that, as I said, one or two experiments will not give you any answer. Unless you do 6, 7, 8 experiments, it starts giving you some data which you can take and then say, yeah, that this is the right direction or the wrong direction I'm going in. We do a lot of everything that we do when it comes to us, we don't go without experiments. Even if it's a small experiment, we go and test it.
Right. Audience, I have to mention this. Thank you for the participation. We are loving the enthusiasm. I see so many questions coming up, and the credit goes definitely to Gaurav for delivering such a brilliant session. We'll try to take as many as we can in today's session. And so continuing with the Q&A, the next question is from Subodh. There are actually two questions from him. Subodh, do you want to come online and ask your question? Please raise your hand if you want to, and I can unmute you. Okay, he's online. Go ahead, Subodh.
Hello, Gaurav. Thank you for the wonderful session. So I have two questions. Yeah. One, what kind of experiments would you recommend for non-software products? And the other one is, how do you narrow down on which customers you'd like to experiment with?
Right. That's a, so yeah, for the first question, which is, so the experiment is very generic, Subodh. Like if you go with the, you know, this experiment is not for a physical or a non-physical product or for a software product. Software is just a medium. Because at the end of the day, if you see a consumer is using multiple services, multiple products. Now, I am a consumer of a toothpaste. I'm a consumer of a car as well. I'm a consumer of a house as well. Now, there are different mediums where your customer segment sits. So it doesn't really matter what product you are in. Experiment is very generic. You can use it for any customer segment. In fact, we are using this experiment, as a service for a lot of FMCG customers where they are selling physical products like Bayer Pharmaceuticals. They make a lot of medicines and vaccines. Of course, I think everybody knows about COVID now. So even these vaccines are physical products. How they are delivered to the customer, whether it's online, offline, even we have tested like how would a consumer like to consume the medicine? Different sachets, different packages. So even the packaging can be tested. And we got really, very good results when the teams were not aligned that how should they focus on packaging a medicine and deliver it to the customer. So I think this experiment is more, as I said, a mindset, and it can be really used for any of the ideas. It really doesn't matter. We are in fact using it for manufacturing companies as well. So we are working with Bosch, we're working with Hilti, where there are no digital products as such
for the entire. Got that. Okay. My second question, how do you choose your customers? How do you know that whom you want to experiment with?
I think that's up to you as an organization that what problem you're trying to solve for the market, who will be those customers. Like I was talking to one of a startup, a very good example just came to my mind three or four weeks back. We were doing a UI, a discovery session with them. So they were very clear. That's where the clarity of customer segmentation comes. So when we asked them, okay, who is your customer segment? They said, okay, we want to target females. Which is so their target is to actually help people improve their health, reduce weight, if you say, and their focus is females in Germany, people who speak German. And then in Germany also they are targeting very specific cities initially, and then it's Switzerland. So I think that's if you see the example, the customer segment will be focused. The quadrant that I showed in one of my slides. So that's where you decide whether you're going with your existing customer segment we are already catering to if you're in existing business, or you're going to go and completely go, completely go to a new customer segment. You'll try to find whether the same problem that you're solving for X customer segment, does it stand for a Y customer segment as well? Like Tata, for example, I think this is a Toyota. Yeah, Toyota example, I was reading that when they launched Camry, they wanted to go into the luxury segment. So Camry started as a luxury segment. There was a completely new customer segment because Toyota initial focus was people who want to buy economical cars. But when there was a competition, they wanted to launch a new customer segment. They wanted to make a car which is luxury, but not as like BMW or Audi or any costly car. So they decided that, okay, we'll continue with the Toyota brand. We'll go into the luxury segment. So luxury segment becomes a new customer segment for them. And then they start, building a car for that customer segment. Does it help you?
Sure. Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Subodh. So I will allow Boy to come online next. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing the name right.
Hello.
Hi. Please go ahead and ask your question.
I don't know why it's saying Boyer. My name's Ronak, actually.
Okay. Right. Ronak, yes, go ahead.
Okay. Hi, Gaurav. Hey. It was a very interesting session. So as I've mentioned in my question, I'm developing an edtech startup. Which is focusing more on holistic education and skill development. And we're making kids ready for the world is what my tagline is. So the problem that I'm facing right now is to understand whether what I'm creating is what my customer really wants. So that customer largely is influenced by their parents.
Exactly.
So my parents are the customers in some cases, whereas in my age bracket where it is 17 and 18, the kids are the customers because that time they don't listen to the parents. They buy whatever they want. So how do I survey them or ask my questions to them, or how do I reach out to them?
Right. So your target market is what, 7 to 18 years or 13 to 18 years?
13 to 18 years.
So I think you need to first break down into two, because you answered your question yourself. So if you're saying 17, after say 17 years, kids can take their own decisions. That means that customer segment is kids for you, right? And if you're targeting a customer segment which is 13 to 14 years, my daughter is also 13, so I know what's going on with me. I think kids today they really press you down and negotiate. But eventually, you're right, the decision is taken by a parent. So it's similar to a corporate world where there is a buyer and there is a user. So if you see here, the kid becomes a user, but the buyer is the parent. So you really need to go and nail down both the customer segments. Now, this becomes like two customer segments for you to deal with. Actually, no, I will not say there are two customer segments, but it's one customer segment, but then there is a user and a buyer. So you have to really... focus here on the buyer and the user as well. So user has to be satisfied that yes, I want to go, and the kid is comfortable going online and doing online classes. I think after COVID, a lot of people have done that now. Kids are already accustomed to tools. It's a very good opportunity for you to start targeting them. But the decision here is the one who will buy, which is a buyer. So you need to really drill down to both. Survey initially will not give you a lot of evidence. As I said, in this case, you could first try to do discovery interviews. Try to find parents which are near your location, near your place. Maybe find a nearby school that you can interact with. Try to go to some teachers, one or two teachers that you know in your community. We can help you bring these kids together. And somehow you reach to their parents and their kids. I'll still say run 20-30 physical Zoom calls with them. Because that will give you the real feel. And don't try to sell them anything. I think that's the biggest mistake that a lot of startups do. What you're trying to do is, when you're in the problem space, if you see the first thing, you're trying to validate the problem. When you try to push your solution a lot, people run away. So you have to really make sure that in your messaging, in your talking, your questions are very, very focused on the problem and not jumping on the solution.
All right. Got it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ronak. Gaurav, I hope you have a little more time for us, because we have so many more questions to go.
Sure.
Right? But audience, let me just remind you, if you want to go for the 30-minute coaching session with Gaurav, which we'll make available very soon, please scan the QR code. And coming to the next question here. Let's take this next question from Digvijay. With the vague target segment in place, what are some recommendations on finding innovation pathways or ideas that are true problems? And second part to that is how to understand the value of a solution to the problem, starting from whether people are willing to pay or not, to how to calibrate it.
Okay. So let me read the question again.
Sure.
With a vague target segment in place, what are some recommendations on finding innovation pathways or ideas that are true problems? Digvijay, sorry, I didn't understand the question. It started with the vague target segment, then I got lost in like what you really mean with the first question. Second one is, how do you understand the value of a solution to the problem, starting from whether the people are willing to pay or not, and how to calibrate it? Now, in the second question, yeah, second question is clear to me. So, as I said, as I explained to in the initial question, that what you're trying to do is not jumping in the solution initially. If you're a startup, if you're starting very, very, very new, what you need to really focus is on the problem first. And yes, you can test in multiple experiments, couple of experiments. So it completely depends on what your hypothesis is. Like in our case, we want to test that, yes, are people willing to pay and how much are they willing to pay? But it could be that in your hypothesis, you don't want to test first. You want to first test, okay, this problem really exists or not? People really know that this is a problem or not, right? And then in the second experiment, you say, okay, now I've identified that people really understand that it's a very big or a very sticky problem and they're not getting any alternative or solutions. Now let's go and find it, how much are they willing to pay? In fact, in a couple of experiments when we did, so face-to-face is very easy. You can quickly put, say, three price options in front of the customer and see which they are clicking or which they are filling. In case of when you broaden your experiment from face-to-face and you go, say, for example, to a landing page running ads, what you could do is put three prices in front of the customer and see which one gets the most clicks and which one wins. So, and that's where you say that you get some feel of it, that are customers willing to pay on a monthly basis? What price can they pay? Are they willing to pay on a six monthly basis? Are they willing to pay on a yearly basis? Now, why I say this is, like, for example, me and my partner, a clear differentiation into customer segments. When we buy any subscription software online, I'm always willing to pay yearly because it gives me discount. But my partner always says, no, let's pay monthly because I want to first test it for 3 months and then decide whether I want to continue with that or not. So it completely depends, So if we are experimented, I'll be the one selecting yearly package. He'll be the one selecting a monthly package. So that's where you start generating this data, that what will make real sense to me. Your assumption could be, no, I'll only sell yearly package. But the data says, no, I have, people who are saying, no, we want to go more with the monthly packages. So the decision will be to maybe first launch with the monthly package and not go with the yearly package and so on.
Right. So I hope that answers your question. And going on to the next question from Sumanta. Sumanta, I saw you raise your hand. Would you want to come online and talk to Gaurav? Please go ahead, Sumanta.
Hi, Gaurav. This is Sumanta here. Great session. Great eye-opener session, I must say. So I had a question, actually, as you were doing with the respiratory space with the pulmonologist, we did a similar project with a large corporate healthcare company. So I was heading that project at that time, around 5 years ago. What it did was we are giving the respiratory care services to the patients at their home. And what we started with was we started with a large survey with a consultant company. And what we did was we went on to survey the patients first. And then basically we launched a product, the solution of taking care of the patient at the patient's home with the 2 visits per month. And then basically what we found was that the solution was good for the patient, but the app that we developed and the reports that were coming into the physicians were of basically less interest to the physicians or the pulmonologists. So what do you basically advise in this case? Should we, when we start with a B2B2C project, should we survey the B2B part first? That is, we should survey the physicians involved or the pulmonologists first, or we should survey the basically the customers first or the patient first?
Yeah.
So what is your take on this?
Yeah. Sumanta, I hate surveys. I'm the last one if you say, okay, let's do service, because service data are like really capturing the feeling of the person. It generally doesn't give you, what you call skin in the game, which I mentioned here. So you rightly said, I think that's a very valid point, that in this case for us as well, why we choose to go. So we were not targeting to go to the pulmonologist or to the doctor. our intent was where could we find patients where we can test it very fast, because these are the people who are visiting the pulmonologist. Fortunately, I knew a couple of pulmonologists through my healthcare relationship. So he said, yeah, that's fine. I don't care. You can come and sit and run the experiment. It's okay. But I never tried to position him in the game. My intent was to directly go to the consumer who gonna put his skin in the game. He is the one who is putting money on the table. Like a pulmonologist could be a recommendation going to the patient. Hey, you buy this device. And this will help you monitor your lungs at home. And then, yeah. And you know, from the app, like I'm not getting into details of the features. I don't want to disclose that. But this was a separate customer segment for us. So I will treat this as two customer segments. One is end consumer buying a product directly, for example. Or end consumer buying a product recommended by pulmonologist. So if I try to test it through pulmonologist, for example, I'll run a separate experiment with pulmonologist. I'll run a separate experiment with the B2C. So for me, it would be eventually going to the consumer through pulmonologist, but it's the pulmonologist who is convincing the customer and the consumer to buy it. So for me, that becomes a separate customer segment.
So you recommended we run two experiments with both the B2C.
Completely separate experiments with both of them.
Great. Thank you for your inputs. Thank you.
Thank you, Sumanta. Gaurav, could we take a few more questions, or how are you for time? I wanted to ask you before I move on.
Yeah, I think I'm good for another 5 minutes.
Sure. Great. So the next question is from Vivek Burada. There are actually three questions. Vivek, if you're online, please raise your hand and we can make this process easier if you want to come online. Sure. Yes, Vivek, please ask your question.
Hi, Gaurav. Thanks for this wonderful session. Yeah. I have this small doubt. I'm working in the fintech space. Like, we're building a small product. Initially, when we developed, we didn't run as much tests as needed. So we actually built a very bad product and gave it to the users. And then user told, this is not what we want. We want so and so. And then we went back and started building that. But now we are almost, we are 50% ready to there, but we want to test it. Like, how do users will take this? So when we did a Google survey, like, we got a very good response and we relied on that. And then it turned out to be very bad execution, like very bad product. So when we are running on hypothesis, is it mandatory to test this hypothesis multiple times with, in the same geography, like a user's geography, but yes, in different demographics, something like that?
As I said, if you remember my slides, one experiment will not give you any data. You have to run multiple experiments. In fact, so once we share the presentation on the infographic of experiment, we have given an evidence meter also for every experiment. So every experiment is not equal. So if you're doing a survey, now, as I said in the last question, I hate surveys because the evidence that survey gives you is actually BS. I'll not do the full form, but discovery interviews really give you a lot of insights, know more about your customer, and to see whether you're going in the right direction. Are you thinking that, yeah, is the customer able to empathize, or you are able to empathize with the customer and find whether you're solving the right problem or not? But as and when you go deep into the experiment, so every experiment will give you more learning. So
right.
If I had time, to really go and do, I will do maybe 20, 30 experiments before I really go and spend time building and building and spending my time into the product. Go ahead.
So what is the success criteria? Suppose if I run a test with a landing page, like, what is the success metric? Like, is the impressions that people who want to know about the product, or the signups are the people who want to pay for the product, like they want to be in the product, or amount of the time spent? How do you define that parameter, considering that 30% of the people are actually spending so much of the time to understand the solution that they're providing? What is the criteria?
That's a great question. I can answer quickly with a couple of examples. Now, in a landing page, impressions is nothing. Impression just gives if people came on the landing page and they exited. What are they doing with the landing page? What do you want them to really do it, right? That's where you define your design your experiment. That when a user comes on my landing page, what do I want the user to do, right? And for example, you just create a fake checkout. You don't have a product, right? You are not in the journey where you're just testing it. you do a fake checkout, you put everything in front of him, a solution, maybe in form of a prototype, a video, explain a video, whatever you call it, and you say buy now. And when he clicks on buy now, he goes to say options of three prices. For example, now you want to test which one is he willing to pay. And then he clicks on that and you take him to a checkout. He puts the product in the cart. You also want to see which product he's putting in the cart. And at the end, you say, oh, sorry. Or you show him a 404 page. But in your whole funnel, when the customer landed on your page, and you can also test, okay, which landing page people are interacting more. So if you want to do an A-B testing, you can do that as well when they initially land on the page. 50% traffic go on page A, 50% go on page B, but all your data is then captured on Google Analytics, and that data should, and then at the end you can say, okay, sorry, we are launching the product, we'll be out soon in the market, sign up to get a free access, right? So when they sign up, give you the email address, or maybe, for example, for me, like the skin in the game is when I go on LinkedIn and set up a call with a prospect customer. Our success criteria, first success criteria is this person commits to a call for 30 minutes. So that's a good, so we give a higher score to that guy compared to other guy who is giving me, who is not giving me a call, but he says, okay, send me an email. So sending an email versus somebody committing to come on a call, like today you're on the call, you're talking to me, you're spending your value time, right? So that's a bigger skin in the game for me. So I'll give you a higher points rather than somebody, going and downloading a presentation later and sending me a message, hey, thanks very much, thanks for running the session. So you have to really define what you want. What do you want the user in terms of their currency or their value, and then decide whether this was successful or not successful.
Success criteria, suppose if I have a 10, 200 to 300 email address, how do I keep communicating with him? What is it without even having the product? How do I create a relationship and convert into the beta user? The product?
Yeah, the second step could be you try to really go and maybe, send something else about your product, about your journey. If you have 200, 250, people who are really interested in an idea, you still want to go and do another test with them that did they really understand what I was trying to do? You can do a quick design sprint with them. So maybe bring 10, 15 people. Now you take your solution. You still not build a product, but you go and maybe build a prototype, take in front of them, see what their reaction is. Are they really willing to, pay for it? How much are they willing to pay, as I said, if you're not tested it before. And then you commit, of course, at some stage that, yes, now I think I have enough evidence or a gut feel that I should go and invest in building product.
Great. Thanks, Gaurav. Thanks.
Thank you, Vivek, for the questions. Gaurav, let's take this one last question from Saurabh. This question, actually, quite a few have the same thing in their mind. As I experience, customers saying, I'm willing to pay, don't usually end up actually buying when the product is out in the market. How to validate the gravity of customers' response?
Customers are not loyal to anyone. Right?
Because there are a few more questions around the same frame of thought. So, if you could just address this as well.
So it's just not willing to pay. See, thing from it's more psychological that today, if you get a problem, you will go and solve that problem. It's not just willing to pay. If you're trying to push your product, which people don't really care about, so it's like, solving a puzzle which has a lot of variables. So they will be willing to pay if you have a right product, if you're solving the right problem. It's simple, right? There is, and if you see a lot of products that this scale, they don't scale on, pushing a lot of ads, lot of inorganic stuff. Most of the products that have scaled in the market, they have scaled organically, because when somebody starts liking the product, you get a wow experience, and you have that budget. For example, willing to pay the customer segment that you're targeting. Like if I am a customer segment who believes in, who has money to drive a Maruti car, and say a BMW guy calls me and say, are you willing to pay for a BMW? Are you willing to pay for, Audi? I'm a wrong customer segment for him, right? But if somebody calls me and say, okay, if I'm a BMW guy and somebody calls me, hey, are you interested in Maruti? Then again, I'm a wrong customer segment for him. So it really, you know, depends on a lot of equations that am I really targeting the right customer segment? Am I solving the right problem for that right customer segment? And then how much are they willing to pay for that? Now, if for example, you sell a Maruti to a Maruti guy, he will talk to you. He will say, yes, I'm looking to buy a car. What's the price of the car? So all that interest that you start generating gives you enough evidence that, yeah, they are willing to pay and they're the right customer segment. And one more thing, which I see most of the products which I'm explaining, they grow organically, where if I like the product, I enjoyed it. Now, the first thing I'm going to do is go and tell 10 more people. So it generate reference, it generate the experience that I get. I want to share the experience with other people, and then they will go and buy that and refer to more. And that's how your engagement or your product growth happens.
That's perfect, Gaurav. And in view of time constraints, audience, we have to end the Q&A here. Thanks for the participation. And I know we haven't answered all the questions, and for that, we have made a platform available. Please scan the QR code and get your 30-minute session with Gaurav, who is a practitioner and a mentor. And with that, I end the Q&A session here. Coming to the next part of the session is going to be so difficult for you, Gaurav, but you will have to pick the best question here, and we will reward them with a free digital course by the Institute. And he's called the champion of curiosity. We have so many curious minds here today, but please help us pick the best one.
So where should I pick it from, the Q&A?
Yeah, Q&A or the answered section. The ones that we took, they are in the answered section. The ones we haven't taken are still open in the Q&A. And I don't know if you remember, but we took a few from the LinkedIn as well. So
yeah. Yeah, sorry guys, there's no biasness. I'll just pick up one and
totally understandable. Audience, while Gaurav picks the best question, please go ahead and let us know your thoughts on the webinar by taking this poll. Let us know your learning experience and feedback from this webinar, and it'll definitely help us and deliver the best webinars in the future as well. So are we ready with the winner, Gaurav?
Yeah, I think I'll go with the name, which you pronounce as, I think, BHOI before, right?
Oh, that's Ronak, actually.
Ronak.
Right. Congratulations, Ronak, on winning the free digital course. And we'll get in touch with you shortly with the award. We have enjoyed having you with us, Gaurav. It's been a complete pleasure.
Yeah.
And same, please accept this certificate of appreciation from the Institute. Yes, Gaurav, you're saying.
I thank everyone to take out their time to have the session. Yeah, it was really insightful. And thanks for challenging me with the questions that you guys had. It helps me also to rethink now and, learn more. Thank you.
Definitely. This has been the best session so far in the new year. And thank you for that, Gaurav. And if you scan the QR code on the certificate, it will take you to a dedicated Hall of Fame page that we have created for you. And it will have the recording as well of the session.
Sure.
Right. So please share it with your network, and we'll be sharing the same on our YouTube channel as well.
Definitely.
We are very grateful for the time and effort you took to share your thoughts and amazing insights drawn from the experience you have in the industry.
Thank you.
And I'm certain that our audience will definitely benefit from the methods you suggested and get ahead in their career.
Definitely.
Thank you once again, Gaurav, for joining us.
Yeah, thanks very much. Have a good night, everyone. Bye.
And audience, thank you for joining in. It was great interacting with you all. Do not forget to register for the upcoming webinar on 23rd. With that note, I end tonight's session. Happy learning and stay skilled. Have a great night.